Welcome you to worship at Davis Park. We have begun our summer schedule of worshiping at 9 a.m. out here at Davis Park and downtown at 10:45. Each of you, whether you are in person or online, welcome. You are important to us and we are excited to worship with you. Pastor Dondina Johnson will bring our message this morning for this Pentecost Sunday. As the body of Christ at Anderson First United Methodist Church, we make disciples for Jesus Christ by following our pathway, living our faith, nurturing families, serving our communities. Next Sunday, June 4th, we will honor our graduates from high school and advanced degrees at 9 a.m. Please contact the church or myself with their names and information, or there is a form on our website that you can complete. We don't want to miss anyone. King's Brass is coming on Sunday, June 4th, for a concert in the downtown sanctuary at 6 p.m. These Christian professionals are from around the United States and will perform music that they have written and they have recorded. For 40 years, the King's Brass have performed with three trumpets, three trombones, a tuba, keyboards, percussion, and outgoing personalities and inspirational commitment to God. Plan to invite your neighbors and friends to join you for that concert. As we now prepare to greet one another with the joy of knowing Jesus Christ and being out here in this beautiful setting, let us now stand and greet one another.
I actually was at Lowe's last week and saw Ian Collins that used to be in the Bible study group. I'm terrible with names, but I know I know you. Tell me your name. You seem to be okay. Yeah, it's just been a crazy weekend. When Mark told his dad yesterday about Matt, and his dad was just fine. Mark's sister and her family are there visiting his dad now, so at least he has somebody there with him. This long-distance stuff is for the first. I mean, you see that with your mom, too.
Yeah, well, we're fortunate that he's got my sister living there, so that's a
plus. Yeah, at least there's a family member there. Yeah, I may, people say, oh, where did you want to live when you retire? I'm like, wherever my kids are.
As you return to your seats, let us now center our hearts for worship with music from the Brass Quintet. Give us hearts and lives ready to serve you in the world, and make us ready for the great adventure that lies ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm looking around and I don't see any of our kiddos here this morning. Are there? Are you hiding somewhere? All right. Well, we want to wish our kids well with every blessing of God on this weekend and in the summer days to follow. Keep them in your prayers and in your hearts throughout this summer. Thank you. The work of the Spirit is to bring life, to implant hope, to give liberty, to testify to Christ, to guide us into truth, to teach us all things, to comfort the believer and to convict the world of sin. Your financial gifts equip the church to join the Holy Spirit in the work of God. The ushers will be among you. They have blue baskets that will collect, or blue boxes that will collect offering and attendance cards if you would like to drop them in those at this time. Also, if you miss them, if they don't get quite to you, there is the blue lockbox at the welcome table. You're always free and welcome to use that as well for your offering today. The ushers will come forward at this time. Let us give to God generously. Spirit of God, Help us to dream dreams and see visions of all the healing and hope that is possible for this world. Use the gifts that we bring to you for your glory and to increase your power beyond this place. Amen. On this Memorial Day weekend, it is appropriate for us to give thanks to God and also to offer our prayers for forgiveness. Let us join in our litany for Memorial Day together. Let us give thanks to God for the land of our birth with all its chartered liberties, for all the wonder of our country's story.
We give you thanks, O God,
for the times we have failed to extend those same liberties to all of our nation's people.
Forgive us, O God,
for leaders in nation and state, and for those who in days past and in these present times have labored for the good of their community.
We give you thanks, O God,
for the times when we have failed to do our part for the common good.
Help us, O God.
For those who in all times and places have been true and brave, and in the commonplace ways of life have lived upright lives and ministered to those people they have met along the way.
We give you thanks, O God.
For the times we have failed to speak the truth and stand up for the right. For those who served their country in its hour of need, and especially for those who gave even their lives in that service.
We give you thanks, O God.
And for the times we have lacked the courage to face our fears.
Help us, O God.
Almighty God and most merciful Father, as we remember these your servants, remembering with gratitude their courage and strength, we hold before you those who mourn them. Look upon your grieving servants with mercy, as this day brings them memories of those who they have lost. May it also bring your consolation and the assurance that their loved ones are alive now and forever in your living presence. May we honor their memory by the way in which we live our lives with you and with each other. Amen. Thank you. quiet our hearts and minds as we go to God in prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, come and set our hearts afire with your love and compassion and power. We are grateful, O God, creator and lover of all people, for your invitation to worship, for this opportunity to praise you, to hear your word and receive it with our hearts. On this day, we come before you in a way that is pleasing to you and good for us. Sincerely and humbly, we ask that you be with us, that you cleanse our speaking and sharpen our listening, and that you awaken and strengthen our willingness to acknowledge you as the master of our lives. O God, breathe into us the fresh breath of your Spirit. Let us be so filled with your presence that we live today and every day with greater grace, deeper love, and renewed joy. Come, Holy Spirit, come and set our hearts afire with your love and compassion and power. As we celebrate the birth of your church, we pray that you will give each of us and the people of this world your peace. We lift before you all the people of our neighborhoods, our partners in ministry, and those who have and those who have not, the goods that bring us such comfort and joy. We hold before you all the people of our city. We pray for healthy relationships among our city officials so that the decisions that are made work for the good of all of us. The rich and the poor, the powerful and the powerless, the decision makers and the marginalized. We pray for those who have been victims of crimes and for those who are perpetrators of those crimes. We pray that you will help us be engaged with one another and with our community so that we can make a difference at all times and all places. Come, Holy Spirit, come and set our hearts afire with your love and compassion and power. Give us courage to hold the value of your kingdom in the midst of the choices we make for ourselves and for your church. Thank you for the privilege of coming to you this morning. Let the light shine where there is darkness. Let there be peace where there is now strife. Let there be courage and confidence where now there is sorrow and anxiety. Hear our prayer, not because we deserve your mercy, but for Jesus' sake, through whom you have claimed us to be your children and have redeemed us for your work in the world. Come, Holy Spirit, set our hearts afire with your love and compassion and power. We pray in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught all his followers to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, by now, you are well aware that this is Pentecost Sunday. It just happens to be my 10th Pentecost celebration among you as a congregation. It's also the third time that I'm your preacher for the day, which, considering that I only preach about one Sunday a month, that's a pretty big percentage. It took me some time to figure out how I was going to approach this significant event in a new way, this birthday of the church event. As I began writing this sermon, I must admit that I wasn't entirely sure what I'd end up saying. I don't have quite the same trouble at Christmas or at Good Friday or Easter, but Pentecost. There has got to be a reason, however, that the early church leaders included it in the calendar of the church year and gave it its own special color. It is pretty obvious on the large wall calendar of the church year that's hanging in the godly playroom. A single red marker stands out among 51 other purple, white, and green markers. And in godly play, Pentecost is referred to as the hot Sunday of the church year. One of our kids, Grace Stout, who is with her grandparents this weekend, has been looking forward to hot Sunday ever since Easter. She even asked that I try to get donuts with orange and yellow and red frosting, sprinkled with Red Hots for after worship. Well, you'll have the standard donuts today, but I got her and all the other kids a box of hot tamales instead. Well, we get ready for the mystery of Christmas with Advent. And we get ready for the mystery of Easter with Lent, and then, because it's such a great mystery, we celebrate Easter for six more Sundays. And one could argue that those six Sundays after Easter are really the time set for getting ready for Pentecost. But there is just one red Sunday in the entire year, and among other reasons, it is there lest we forget. Seems to me that we have enough trouble remembering as it is that the power of God, which was gifted to us in wind and fire, belongs to us today, every day. We'd better designate at least one day of the year to be reminded. So let's hear again Luke's reporting in the book of Acts of the beginning of that story, the day the Holy Spirit made a home in the people of God. When the feast of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind, gale force. No one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building. Then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks and started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. There were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. When they heard the sound, they came on the run. Then when they heard, one after another, their own mother tongues being spoken, they were blown away. They couldn't, for the life of them, figure out what was going on. And they kept saying, "Aren't these all Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother tongues?" Parthians, Medes, Elamites, visitors from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, immigrants from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, even Cretans and Arabs. They're speaking our languages, describing God's mighty works. Their heads were spinning. They couldn't make head nor tail of it. They talked back and forth, confused. What's going on here? Others joked. They're just drunk on cheap wine. In the Jewish tradition, the Feast of Pentecost comes 50 days after Passover and is one of the great festivals of Thanksgiving after the crops have been harvested. The festival was so widely celebrated that people from all over the known world came to Jerusalem, not only Jews, but God-honoring, God-seeking people from many lands and cultures and languages also came. As this incredible day began, followers of Jesus, not just the apostles, but many other of Jesus' disciples, were gathered together in one place. And without warning, the sound of gale force winds came out of nowhere, and like wildfire, Holy Spirit flame danced over their heads. But what must have been the most amazing thing of all, when they opened their mouths to speak, it wasn't their own language that was heard. The words that poured forth were words they had not grown up with. They hadn't studied or learned them, and they weren't gibberish or gobbledygook either. In that instant of time, what poured forth with energy and fluency and courage were the languages of the world. When all the pilgrims who had heard the sound of gale force winds came running to see what was going on, and when they saw the dancing flames and heard the praise and descriptions of God's mighty acts in their own language, no less, they were confused. What in heaven's name is going on? I'm reminded of a little poster that hangs above the sacristy table in the Godley Playroom. It's a recreation of Da Vinci's The Last Supper. On the poster, instead of the usual disciples depicted, the men seated at the table are Africans and Hispanic, Indians and various other indigenous people. The caption at the top asks the question, what language would he use to speak to each of these? The answer printed just below the question reads, their own. The first observation that I would make today is this. It seems to me that what we have here is one truth about the way the Holy Spirit works in our lives. The story of God, the mighty work of God through Jesus Christ, is communicated by the humblest of folk in such a way that it is understood by those who could not have understood it otherwise. And it is not just that these disciples were suddenly bilingual, but it is the message that these humble followers of Jesus communicated that was an equal miracle. These disciples didn't have it all figured out yet. They still had their questions and their doubts. They had no clue about what they were going to do now that Jesus was gone from their midst. But it is the way of the Holy Spirit to take our faithful questions and doubts, even our very confusion, and make it come out right. Somehow, our words and our actions communicate the love and grace of God through Jesus Christ. Understanding is a wonderful thing. The eloquence makes it easy on the ear. But lest we take credit here, the miracle work of communication comes through the power of the Holy Spirit alive and at home in us. Here's the second observation I would make. The Holy Spirit is a free spirit. You never know where the Spirit will show up. You never know how the Spirit will show up. You never even know what the Spirit is going to do. But you can be sure that from time to time, as the Spirit lives in you, you will be ridiculed and dismissed, if not persecuted outright, for the things that you say and do. Seeing this Pentecost outpouring, some joke, they're just drunk. Sometimes even we do not recognize the work of the Holy Spirit among us, because that work is just too unusual or too unexpected. Sometimes even we throw water all over Holy Spirit fire because it threatens our regular and comfortable routine, because it asks that we exercise faith and trust in a power and force we cannot see or control. Friends, the Holy Spirit is a free spirit, and it is our privilege to let go of any attempt to control God's work and to go with the flow, so to speak, for the sake of God's mission in the world. Of course, Peter was compelled to respond to the scoffers and jokers among the crowd. He had to also respond to the poor, confused souls, those hearing their own language from a bunch of Galilean peasants, and those Galilean peasants who were testifying in a language that they hadn't grown up with. Listen to his words. That's when Peter stood up and, backed by the other 11, spoke out with bold urgency. Fellow Jews, all of you who are visiting Jerusalem, listen carefully and get this story straight. These people aren't drunk, as you suspect. They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is what the prophet Joel announced would happen. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, also your daughters. Your young men will see visions. Your old men dream dreams. When the time comes, I'll pour out my spirit on those who serve me, men and women both, and they'll prophesy. I'll set wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and blowing smoke and the sun turning black and the moon blood red before the day of the Lord arrives, the day tremendous and marvelous. And whoever calls out for help to me, God, will be saved. I wonder if in that moment Peter took a breath and thought, wow, where did that come from? Infused with God's Holy Spirit wisdom, he drew from his knowledge of the scriptures and reinterpreted Joel's prophecy of the last days to explain what was happening at that very moment. The gift of the Holy Spirit had been promised centuries before, a gift that didn't discriminate among God's people. It was not as though the people had not known of or heard of the Holy Spirit. The prophets had all received a portion of the Spirit's empowering to speak God's word to God's people when it was needed, or to perform signs and wonders in the name of God as God directed. There was even a time when the people of God were wandering around in the wilderness, and Moses, weary from doing all the work himself, asked God for some help. And when God's Spirit came upon Eldad and Medad outside of protocol, some complained. And Moses, no doubt weary of the complaints of even his helpers, declared, "Would to God that all God's people were prophets." Now, the Holy Spirit was not a new concept. But now, from this day forward, the Holy Spirit didn't just come and go, empowering for a moment and withdrawing. The Holy Spirit didn't come upon particular men or particular women. From this day, the Holy Spirit was present in all of God's people, the old and young men and women, always, at all times. And the Apostle Paul later expanded this list to include even slaves and Gentiles. A third observation is clear. The Spirit, the gift of God's Spirit is given to all Jesus' followers. Every one of us, no matter age, gender, social status, even those people who we think are the least likely to be empowered by God's Spirit for God's work among us. Everyone must have a voice, because God's truth, God's way, has a way of revealing itself among the most unexpected of us. We simply must pay attention. We cannot ignore or dismiss the voice or ministry of anyone who loves the Lord. Now, Peter wasn't finished yet. With a fiery passion and courage, he brought his Spirit-inspired sermon forward from the time of the prophets to his present day and to the heart of it all. "Fellow Israelites," he continues, "listen carefully to these words. Jesus, the Nazarene, a man thoroughly accredited by God to you. The miracles and wonders and signs that God did through him are common knowledge. This Jesus, following the deliberate and well thought out plan of God, was betrayed by men who took the laws into their own hands and was handed over to you. And you pinned him on a cross and killed him. But God untied the death ropes and raised him up. Death was no match for him. This God, this Jesus, God raised up. And every one of you here is a witness to it. Then, raised to the heights at the right hand of God and receiving the promise of the Holy Spirit from his Father, he poured out the Spirit he had just received. That is what you see and hear. All Israel, then, know this. There's no longer room for doubt. God made him Master and Messiah, this Jesus whom you killed on a cross." Well, that was risky. First claiming that Jesus was the Messiah, and then accusing his listeners of killing the Messiah on a cross. Peter, the Peter we all know, would never have taken that risk without the power and passion of the Holy Spirit so filling him up that he could not help but speak the truth out loud. I'm not sure what he expected when he took his next breath and looked around at the faces of those he was preaching to. Luke reports it this way. "Cut to the quick, those who were listening asked Peter and the other apostles, 'Brothers, so what do we do?' Peter said, 'Change your life. Turn to God and be baptized, each one of you, in the name of Jesus, so that your sins are forgiven. Receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is targeted to you and your children, and also to all who are far away. Whomever, in fact, our Master God invites.'" And he went on in this vein for a long time, urging them over and over, get out while you can, get out of this sick and stupid culture. That day, 3,000 took him at his word, were baptized, and were signed up. They committed themselves to the teaching of the apostles, to life together, the common meal, and the prayers. Here's the final observation I would make of this text on this Pentecost Sunday. You never know what the result will be when the Holy Spirit shows up and when you give way and allow the Spirit power to take control. More than we can ask or imagine. That's how the Apostle Paul would respond. More than we can ask or even imagine. Why would we settle for anything less? Peter's risky sermon became the seeds of repentance, and 3,000 took him at his word. They were baptized and committed themselves to growing in faith through word and deed. And they committed themselves to life together with other believers. Everything changed. You wouldn't even recognize them. I've often wondered why the Holy Spirit came to God's people in gale force winds and wildfire. I wonder if it is because gale force winds and with gale force winds and wildfire, everything changes and nothing remains the same. In the natural world, it can well be a force of destruction. Recent wildfires in California and Australia, fueled by gale force winds, destroyed everything in their path. Everything changed, the landscape as well as the people. By contrast, wind and fire of the Holy Spirit brings change that makes everything new. Why would we settle for less? The people of God were faced with a daunting task when they returned from exile to Babylon. The Persian King Cyrus had allowed them to return to their land, but the temple, the city of Jerusalem, and its walls that had been destroyed by the Babylonians were in further ruin after their 70 years of exile. They were discouraged, and with few resources at hand, they held little hope of meeting the task God was calling them to complete, the rebuilding of the temple and the city walls. Then the prophet Zechariah came among them and encouraged them with these words, "It is not by might or by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord." And the people set to work. Friends, we have all the resources we need to do the work that God calls us to do. We do. The Spirit of God is alive and at home in each one of us. So it seems to me that the most important and first question we should ask individually as well as a congregation is this: who is God calling us to be? And secondly, what is God calling us to do? If we get those answers right, we don't need to worry about the resources to get it done. On this Pentecost Sunday of 2023, how might we reimagine the mission of God in this congregation if we faithfully anticipated an outpouring of Pentecost proportions today? Would we welcome it? Let us pray. For the gift of wind and fire, we thank you, O God. Give us the wisdom and courage of Pentecost so that we will be the people empowered by and relying on your Spirit to do all that you call us to do. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Benediction. Go now in the power and peace of the Holy Spirit. Amen.